phones or other electronic signaling devices. The procedures for this public hearing are located in the lobby, along with the agenda and copies of the staff recommendations for today's hearing. Meeting schedules and agendas for the City Planning Commission are available online. Staff reports and maps for the City Planning Commission hearings will be available online approximately 1 week prior to the public hearing. To access this information, log on to www.norfolk.gov/planning. If you wish to speak on an item on today's agenda, you must fill in a request form with a staff member located in the council chamber. We normally hear items in the order in which they are listed on the agenda. The planning staff will introduce each item by stating the type and purpose of the application and the location of the property. A staff member will deliver a presentation on each item, followed by a recommendation on each application to be considered at the hearing. Following the staff presentation, the commission will hear from proponents and then opponents, if there are any. Anyone who has signed in to speak will be called by the chair. He or she should approach the podium, state his or her name and mailing address. The speaker should speak directly to the commission and not to the audience. Remarks will be limited to 3 minutes each. However, the applicant's time will not be limited. After all proponents and opponents have been heard, the commission will allow rebuttal from first proponents, then opponents. Total time for the rebuttals are limited to 5 minutes each. At the conclusion of the hearing on each item, and after considering all information presented to the commission, we'll take action on the matter. Action on each matter by the commission will be recommended approval or denial by majority vote. The statement of the motion in the affirmative by a member of staff is a matter of voting procedure and in no way indicates the recommendation of the staff or consensus of the commission. Following the action by the commission on the matter, a written recommendation will be made to City Council, except for those applications where the decision of Planning Commission is final. Anyone who attends the commission public hearing for a specific item will be notified by the City Clerk's office of the date on which the City Council will consider the application. However, it is the responsibility of each applicant to contact the City Clerk's office to confirm the hearing date and time of City Council public hearing. Susan, please call the roll.
Ms. Austin?
Here.
Ms. Shelton?
Here.
Mr. Bateman?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
Mr. Pendleton?
Here.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
And Mr. Murphy?
I am here. Thank you. Under a consent agenda today, we have three items. No.
Before we start, we have some withdrawal items.
Okay.
So before taking up the items on today's agenda, we will consider the following request for withdrawal. Regular agenda item number 5, Bay and Sea Rentals, for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental at 864 Little Bay Avenue. And regular agenda item number 7, Andy Lunday, for a conditional use permit to operate short-term rental vacation unit vacation rental at 1106 Toller Place. Ms. Austin? Oh, that's a withdrawal. We're not going to do that. Now we're moving on to the consent.
Great. Thank you. We have three items under the consent agenda. No one has signed up to speak against any of these items. The items are for Brothers, Caponera Ramen, and Bonchan Norfolk. Commissioners, are you comfortable voting on the consent agenda as published?
Yes.
Yes.
That's not a vote. We'll actually vote on it now.
The motion is to recommend approval of Brothers for the following conditional use permits at 300 Monticello Avenue, space 147. A, for a restaurant with sale of alcoholic beverages on premises. B, extended hours of operation. C, live entertainment. Number 2, Capo Naro Ramen, for the following conditional use permits at 2000 Colonial Avenue, Suite 7, A, restaurant with sale of alcoholic beverages for on-premises, B, sale of alcoholic beverages off-premises, and 3, Bonchan Norfolk 3052, for conditional use permit at 273 Granby Street to operate a restaurant with the sale of alcoholic beverages on-premise. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make those recommendations to City Council. Thanks to those applicants for coming downtown. And we appreciate you being here. Continued agenda?
Yep. First item on the continued agenda is Community Power Group LLC for a conditional use permit at 2400 Berkeley Avenue to operate a solar energy collection facility, large scale. The purpose of the request is to allow a solar energy facility.
Thank you, Susan. Good afternoon, commissioners. This property is the old Campostella landfill. It is east of Berkeley Avenue and Campostella Road. The future land use map designates the site as open space and recreation, and this use would comply with that. It is currently zoned open space preservation. In this zoning district, a solar energy collection facility large scale requires a conditional use permit to operate here. That was done as a result of a zoning text amendment you guys passed in 2022. Here's the proposed site plan. This is an 8-megawatt facility, which should be enough to power 2,400 residential homes. You can see it covers a large part of the facility. Moving here into the next slide, we see an example of a similar project that Community Power Group, the applicant, has done. This was a much smaller facility, only 1.2 megawatts, and this was in Maynard, Massachusetts. So on the left-hand side of your screen is how the construction will go and how the solar panels will look when they're constructed. Because the landfill is capped, they can't penetrate the ground, so this construction method doesn't penetrate the cap this way. And DEQ will approve their construction plan and monitor the construction as it goes on to make sure that cap stays intact. The applicant is also going to plant pollinator-friendly ground cover on site where practicable. As I said downstairs, we believe this is the first solar-friendly solar landfill in Virginia. Moving on to our recommendation, the project conforms with the objectives of Plan Norfolk 2030 and is an important step towards making Norfolk a sustainable, biophilic, and resilient city. Staff recommends approval subject to the conditions in the staff report, which include the pollinator-friendly ground cover, a privacy fence to be installed along Berkeley Avenue, and landscaping shrubs along Berkeley Avenue. Those were not shown in the rendering because there's some issues to be worked out with the location due to the water line for the fire hydrant and existing stormwater drains on site, but the applicant has agreed to those conditions. Stand by for any questions.
Thanks, Rob. Any questions for Rob at this point? The applicant representative is here to speak. Rachel Boots.
Hi. Good afternoon. My name is Rachel Boots, and I am an engineer and project manager at Community Power Group.
May we have your mailing address?
Yes, 4445 Willard Avenue, Chevy Chase, Maryland.
Thank you.
So we have operating solar landfill operations in Massachusetts and Maryland, and we're really excited. We're starting construction this year on the first Virginia one, which is in Charlottesville, Virginia, and then hopefully here in the city of Norfolk. Solar on landfills is a great way to repurpose otherwise undevelopable land, and we're really excited about this opportunity because we responded to the city of Norfolk's RFP that was issued in 2021. We are awarded the RFP proposal through a competitive process. We heard of our award in June of 2022. So since then, we've been working on our interconnection applications with Dominion, which are a long lead process, working through this conditional use permit application and engaging in community outreach efforts with the Norfolk Environmental Sustainability and Neighborhood Development Specialist. So our community outreach effort started when we first applied with our pre-application meeting, which was held in September. Then we attended the quarterly Southside Task Force meeting in January. And most recently, along with city staff, we hosted a project-specific meeting on Monday, March 20th, at the Berkeley Recreation Center. This meeting consisted of a presentation and breakout sessions so attendees could ask detailed questions, and it resulted in really productive conversation. We found many individuals were interested in ensuring the city's revenue goes to projects on that side, since this project does generate a lot of revenue for the city. A project-specific website has also been created. It's available on the City of Norfolk's website, and FAQ sheet is available on there as well. So I want to go over a little bit of the details that Rob covered as well, but it's an 8-megawatt solar facility. The cap will not be disturbed during construction because the panels sit on concrete blocks so that we don't penetrate the ground as we would if it was a grass field. The existing fence along the property is to be maintained. This is really important because there's a lot of embedded vegetation in that fence that we want to maintain because it really screens the landfill from sight today. So we don't want to disturb that vegetation, and we'll do a full assessment and repair and replace as needed throughout. But then based on the feedback from this commission, we have agreed to do some streetscape improvements along the Berkeley Avenue frontage, which would be the concrete entrance, which we are improving, the shrubbery along the entrance, and also a secondary screening fence to block, you know, kind of that chain link fence that we hope to maintain. Then, let's see, another thing I wanted to point out was we will have the pollinator-friendly ground cover, which Rob mentioned, and this wildlife is proven to better protect topsoil as well. So we're happy to incorporate that element into our plan. The project is designed to have low to no impact on the landfill and the surrounding community. It's an out-of-sight landfill today, and it will be an out-of-sight landfill with solar on it tomorrow. Solar has no emissions, no traffic, no lights, no glare, no noise, and no impact to property values based on numerous studies. So with the city's approval of this land use, and once we receive our interconnection, those are the two things that we need to be able to apply for the Virginia Community Solar Program. If we get that approval, we would be able to build the 5-megawatt community solar facility on the site. The 5 megawatts is the max community solar allowed in the state. And so the remaining 3 to make the total 8 would be distributed generation, which goes directly to the grid. And also 3 is the max allowed size for distributed generation. So we were very happy with the size of the site and the slopes that we analyzed to be able to fit all 8 megawatts, because we're able to maximize the land use benefit and the rent revenue for the city of Norfolk. At the end of the life of the project, the solar will be decommissioned. That's fully on the solar operator's expense. And we will remove all electrical equipment, the concrete ballast, and the site is returned to pre-development conditions. I think that was all the project details I had to go over, but I'm happy to answer any questions now or later.
Thank you very much. Any questions for Ms. Boots?
Yes. So what determines the lifespan of the facility?
So right now we have a lease in place, or our proposed lease is for 20 years with option to renew, and that is based on the current life cycle of panels. With the exception, you know, as time goes on, maybe 1 or 2 would have to be replaced. But overall, the facility, we're expecting 35 years of life cycle for panels. You know, at the end of those 35 years, if the relationship and everything is going well and there's still opportunity for solar, we might be able to upgrade the facility and create a new lease at that time.
Thank you.
But 35 years is the market trend right now.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions. Could you, you mentioned, I attended the community meeting on Monday, and the EJ40 initiative was mentioned. Could you tell us specifically how that program is related to this project?
Yeah, absolutely. So this project is able to qualify for investment tax credits that are provided under the Inflation Reduction Act, because the EJ40 requires 40% of all Inflation Reduction Act funding goes to EJ communities. So this project, it has been identified as an environmental justice community, so it would be a benefactor of that governmental funding, which is what makes the project feasible.
Would the community benefit from this, or the company, from those tax credits?
The tax credits help fund the project.
So they would benefit the company, not the community. I think that was a source of confusion. It was mentioned as if the community would benefit in some way.
EJ40
that's,
40
that's
is for...
That's what made me scratch my head. I'm like, well, I know that it was mentioned, but how is that related during this community event while the conversation was around how the community would benefit? It was mentioned, I thought, in that way. And it sounds, and I'm hearing you say that, no, it would just benefit the company's bottom line.
That is correct. Yeah, the EJ40 requires that any government spending towards the Inflation Reduction Act go to environmental justice communities. So by qualifying for that funding, we're able to do this project.
Got it. Next one is you need to sign up. I'm sorry, you need to apply to the DEQ. What is what specifically are you applying for them?
So they monitor all landfill activities. So there's a post-closure permit modification that we may need to do. In Charlottesville, it was deemed, you know, since we're not modifying the cap, the permit wasn't needed, but we still want to go through that process and have their formal acknowledgement that a closure permit modification isn't needed.
I see. And last question. Well, it's not the last question. I have a lot of questions. How will the panels be secured to the ground? I know you said the concrete blocks, but now I'm wondering about storm surges, hurricanes, and nor'easters and such.
Yeah, so the concrete blocks have a wind rating. We'll work with a structural engineer on that. And they so the concrete blocks are spread out maybe every 14 feet, and then there's steel connectors that the panels then sit on. And so it's very similar to rooftop, like large warehouse rooftop installation practices, because they don't want to penetrate those rooftop membranes either for, you know, leaks. So it's very similar to that, which has proven to withstand storms in other
cities.
You don't
have the wind rating, though?
I don't have that on hand, no.
Okay. And then also during the meeting, you mentioned assistance with signing up for credits, and also it was mentioned the potential for hiring community members, people who live on the South Side. Could you say more about both?
Sure, yeah. So the first portion was the credits. So how that works is, you know, we're creating the solar facility, community solar. It's basically competition to Dominion customers. So people who are getting a Dominion energy bill are able to then sign up for the community solar and buy their energy from us instead. Dominion does have a minimum bill that's $55. So as long as your monthly bill is more than $55, anything above that $55, you know, you could buy from us instead at a discounted price. So what we would like to do, and, you know, we've been working with the City of Norfolk staff already and continue that relationship to have meetings with the neighborhoods that were at that meeting to have information available for sign-up instructions, more details once in a, it's, you know, before you sign up for any subscription, there's terms of services that we'd be able to go over line by line to make sure everyone understands what they're agreeing to. And that's something we're committed to. So meet in-person meetings, you know, maybe a link on the City of Norfolk website to subscribe to our facility. We are the ideas we currently have to facilitate that. Then the jobs portion, we've been talking with Council Member Royster about the Norfolk Works platform that you guys have. So making the job postings available on there, as well as also communicating it to those same neighborhoods before construction starts, you know, ample time before construction starts to advertise the jobs to local community members.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have a question. This is a public, this is a private relationship. The RFP was originated, what, by the city or by Dominion?
The city.
It was by the city?
Yeah, the city owns the landfill. And so the RFP was for a lease to use the landfill in an environmentally beneficial way.
Okay. And the partnering between your firm and Dominion is because... It's not a direct relationship with the neighborhood, is what I'm saying, which has happened in certain places.
It's needed because we connect to their wires. So the Dominion wires that are right outside the site, we use that infrastructure to connect the solar facility to the grid.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions at this time? All right, please stand by.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We've got a few people signed up to speak in opposition to this application. Lawrence Brown.
Good afternoon, Commission. My name is Lawrence Brown, 925 Waltham Street, Norfolk, Virginia, current president of the Campostella Heights Civic League. I'm here tonight to ask the Commission to have a 30-day continuance on this project. And if you ask me why, the reasons are is that the company has done a insufficient, non-informative job of letting the community know how this project works, what goes on with this project, how it benefits the community, and how it affects this community. They came out in January and presented a presentation. As I said, was very insufficient, wasn't very informative. Most members of the community of the South Side left asking questions, both to their city leaders and to their civic league leaders, not understanding what the project was about, how the project benefited the community, where the funds were going that the city had getting from that, which I know is not on them. They came back on Monday, which is kind of a coincidence that they are having a meeting today before the commission to get this project approved. And they came back on Monday, and the last meeting was in January. They came back in on Monday and kind of presented the same presentation. Again, the presentation was limited. They broke us up into groups, which allowed them to kind of have questions and answering questions. We were only able to get, after the four different groups met, two questions that could be totally answered to the general audience. So we're asking as a community for this commission to continue this for 30 days until this company comes back to the Southside community where this is being built, where it affects us, and give us more information. If they had done a good job at doing this, I probably wouldn't be standing here today, because I'm in favor of solar energy. But I'm not in favor of you coming into my neighborhood or my community and doing something and not informing us of what's going on. So I would hope that this commission would take in consideration, this project is not due to start until 2025. So I think they have plenty of time to come back to this commission for this to be approved by you after they come to this community on the South Side, again, where it's being built, how it's gonna affect us. I know they have nothing to do with where the money goes that they give to the city, but they should at least respect us enough to come in our community and give us a formal presentation and let us know what's going on.
Thank you very much for your comments, Mr. Brown.
Ladies and gentlemen, have a good evening.
Next, also signed up to speak in opposition is Alton Robinson.
Good evening. My name is Alton Robinson. My address is 5116 East Prisan Road. I also attended the meeting on Monday. I don't know which meeting the lady attended that spoke up here and said it was very productive for the company. It wasn't a very productive meeting. The people was broke up into three different groups. At the end of the meeting, they asked two questions. And I was concerned about the fact that the justice for the initiative that they spoke about was told to me by the person that was an executive director of the company that the 40% had nothing to do with money, no resources at all. So my concern is, where is the community going to benefit? If I'm not mistaken, from what I was reading in the Justice for the Initiative, 40% of the overall monies that go to any projects that's funded by the federal government is to be going towards disadvantaged, underserved, and marginalized communities. And she, the lady, just sent up here and stated that zero money goes to the community. It's 100% of the company's community or money. So if I agree with Brother Brown that you all would not vote on approving this for at least 30 days, it's not a rush. They got 2025 to start it. So give them time to kind of iron out what the community has to say about it, and also come up with something where they could give the community a chance to be an investor in the company, some type of stock, some type of bond, anything, but for the company to come to the community and the community reaps no benefit at all, period. That's a injustice. And the Biden and Harris administration is to bring about justice, at least 40% of it. So for this to approve that, I think it would do a disservice to the community. And that's my take on it. All right. Thank you very much.
Appreciate your comments. Also signed up in opposition but does not want to speak is Sharon Hendrick. Did I miss any of the people who signed up to speak in opposition?
I think she might have.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. It says, I do not wish to speak. Would you like to speak?
Yes.
Come on up.
Good afternoon. Maybe I misunderstood the form. The young lady helped me out with it. My name is Sharon Hendrick, and I am the Civic League President, Campostella, directly where the project would be located. I live at 1201 Midland Street, and I'm here on behalf of the community because the literature that was given to us was insufficient. I became president of the Civic League in September of 2021. About October of 2021, I had gotten wind of a landfill project being proposed for our neighborhood. I asked the liaison, city liaison, Zamari Love, about any information or literature that was out concerning the project. At that time, she had nothing. Then comes January 2023. They had a representative to come and speak to us. The presentation wasn't as, the font wasn't as big as this. The handout wasn't as big as that. He didn't seem like he was well versed in presenting the information to us. We left with questions. Then we were asked to meet with the representatives of Community Solar Project and as an executive board membership. The meeting was canceled by myself because at the 2 days prior to the meeting, they wanted to do a Zoom meeting. I was not asked, could we do a Zoom? I was under the assumption that the meeting was going to be face-to-face and in-person. So I canceled the meeting with our executive board, and they went ahead and had the meeting anyway. Still to this day, our community does not have any clarity because the issues, the questions, we can't answer. I can't even answer. And I'm going to be held accountable for what happens in my neighborhood. So I am asking for the committee here, the Planning Commission, to give us a stay of at least 30 days so that we can meet with Ms. Boots. I did get her card on Monday night, and I told her that we needed some more information. Again, like my colleagues stated, the presentation was broken down where we went into three groups. It did not allow for us to have any questions that were addressed in the group that I was in. So we're still left with no information. And again, I ask and beg of you guys to just count at least 30 days for us to receive some sufficient information so that the residents, not just myself, but the residents who are much older in my community, the average age is like 70 years old, and they don't understand social media. We did have postcards sent out by the city, but it was very limited. We had a handful of representatives from our neighborhood there, probably about 15, 20 people. So I don't even, a couple of people I asked, they didn't get anything. So I'm just asking for 30-day stay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I believe I accidentally skipped over Jay Boone, who also signed up to speak in opposition.
Hello. I'm Jay Boone. Hi, Jay Boone. I am the president of CUSP, which is a nonprofit dealing with the community, and I am a resident of Berkeley.
Can we get your mailing address, please?
It's Berkeley. That's.
Do you have a physical address or mailing address?
I'm a Berkeley resident. I don't understand the need to give the address.
It's just procedure, so that you can receive notifications.
I don't need any. I'll come to you.
Okay.
Thank you. What if I told you I wanted to enter into a deal with you that guaranteed profits for me while not being able to tell you that what you would be able to benefit from the deal? Would you make that deal? While I'm happy to see that the city is making sure that marginalized areas in the city get necessary relief needed, I am against passing of this agenda item because while we are acknowledging the need of the community, we are essentially profiting off of them with no plans to actually rebuild the community. You say we will get jobs. Community Power Group LLC will train people to work on 20 jobs for 20 weeks. After that part of the job is done, they will only guarantee two positions after that, an on-call electrician and a landscaper that is guaranteed because they want to protect the trees in the landfill. That means the community will benefit for 20 weeks versus the 20 years that the city will benefit. You say it will help the direct community save money. Those savings that we are being offered is open to everyone in Hampton Roads, meaning Virginia Beach, Suffolk, Chesapeake, any of those residents can receive those savings and not the general public that you're saying needs it the most. And also, those savings are roughly about $20 a month per household. When I asked them if they could guarantee the savings by capping the subscription sold at $2,400, they said there's no guarantee on that. You say that the community can go to the city council and ask to apply for the available profits to apply to projects that are needed in the community. We have collectively been coming to the city council for help in investing in our community programs, and our cries have been going unheard. Why should we believe you all now? Everyone gets paid except the community that needs the most. Tax credits go to the community and to the company, and the community gets and the city council gets profits. Those are guaranteed, but the community gets nothing. The direct community gets nothing. The community that may already be struggling to pay bills now has to figure out how to pay two bills. When we asked what happens if someone doesn't pay the bill to CPG, they said that it would go into collections. When asked if there was a plan to help with anybody if that happened, they said, oh, there's nothing on record right now. Which is a direct violation when you're dealing with marginalized communities. If you know people are already going through issues such as this, there's a lot of people since COVID and otherwise that have reached out for direct assistance from Dominion Power. So now they're going to have to worry about two bills that could possibly now implement and go against them. You say, I just want you to keep the same standards. When someone comes, this company, CPG, is not a local business. Nobody in the company lives locally. No one is here if something goes wrong. They have on-call people, but those people are not even guaranteed to come from the community. There's nothing in the writing that says that the electrician or the landscaper has to come from this area. So again, they are putting into the city and they're getting the money from it. They're getting the tax credits. You guys are getting the profits and the community has no guarantees. Why is that right? I don't understand how you can continue to put things in motion without actually protecting the people
much.
You say you do. Thank you.
So we're going to move into the rebuttal period. Everyone who signed up to speak has spoken. Ms. Boots, you have 5 minutes to speak if you'd like.
I'm disheartened to hear that the community doesn't feel like ample information has been provided. We are trying our best, working directly with the neighborhood specialist, the environmental sustainability group, creating the website, creating a four-page FAQ. The need for the conditional use permit, which is why we're applying well in advance of the 2025 started construction, is because we cannot apply for the community solar capacity until we have a permit. And that capacity does have a cap. And that is why we're here today in 2023 trying to get this permit so that the permit will allow us to offer the benefits of the community solar program to the residents with a guaranteed discount on their electricity bills. I think there was some confusion about the meetings. We did work with the city to send out 2,000 mailers to the surrounding tenant associations and civic leagues. The landfill is not actually in any civic league proper. It is outside any civic league. So that's why I think there is a missed opportunity back in September 2022 when we had our first meeting, because there wasn't a good contact for any civic league since it's not a civic league. But we rectified that and have been working since January 2023 to, communicate as much as we can and are open to ideas on future communication. But I do ask that this Planning Commission move this project forward so we can continue the communication over the years and work towards getting the permit, which is just a small step in the overall goal.
Thank you. Please stand by. Now, opponents, you have 5 minutes in total for the rebuttal period. You divide that up among yourselves as you'd like.
Thank you. Thank you again, Commission. Lawrence Brown, Campostella Heights City League President. I hear what the young lady is saying, but I'm still here standing here to ask you to give a 30-day continuing. We found out more in this meeting than in the 10 minutes or 5 minutes or whatever she did speaking, then the whole community knows about this project. And again, I'm going to put it as one of my most elderly seniors in my neighborhood put it. If you lived in 925 Waltham and the guy at 927 Waltham built a treehouse in the back of your yard and gave you the information that they have provided to the community, you would be here today doing the same thing I'm doing. They did not come in and give adequate information to the citizens. We wouldn't be here. Again, we don't oppose solar energy. We're all for solar energy. They haven't clarified how the subscription portion of this is going to work. They haven't clarified a lot of things. We're just asking as a community for this commission to continue this for 30 days to allow them to come back and do what's right for the community. And that's to come in, give a presentation that we understand, that we get to ask questions at, and we can move forward. But I will continue to say we're not against solar energy. We're against the company and how they disrespected our community. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I just like to say I'm here for the community. The lady said the community does not benefit monetarily. 40% are to go towards community based on the Justice for the Initiative, and it's mandated. So that's what I stand for. Thank you.
Thank you.
What a few seconds I have. We need clarity. There has not been any transparency throughout this whole ordeal. They've been more transparent with the city versus the residents of the community. That we cannot stand for. We don't want to be overlooked. We pay taxes. We want you guys to give us 30 days so that they can work it out with us, not with the city. Because the part with the city has failed.
Thank you very much.
Outside of transparency, we just need reciprocity. If you all are going to benefit from it, the citizens and the community that you're saying is so marginalized to need this needs to be impacted as well. It doesn't make sense for it to go the other way. And it shouldn't be that we have to come to the city council for anything. If we have civic leagues, the citizens should be able to go to those civic leagues and figure out how to divvy up the profits to help our community. All we're asking is for you to help us invest in ourselves so we can help ourselves and stop standing in the way of that. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to close the rebuttal period. Commissioners, any questions of the applicant or discussion?
Yes. I have a question, and it's not of the applicant, it's of staff.
To you, Rob.
So it's not really maybe of planning staff, but you're going to be the one to have in the hot seat, I guess.
It's fine.
So as a former city employee who was in charge of a lot of RFPs, what department sent out this RFP? What department does this RFP reside under?
My understanding is that
The RFP went through General Services.
The RFP went through General Services, and there was some sort of process they went through to choose this company.
Yes.
State-mandated process.
Yes. Okay. There were three applications submitted, and Community Power Loop was the one selected.
Okay, so they were selected. What kind of community outreach has there been before the RFP was? And you may not know, but I'm kind of making a statement more than asking a question. I'm concerned about what community outreach there was prior to the selection and then post-selection, other than when they're coming for a CUP. So I don't know if you know. I know everything that's happened since they got it, but I don't know what happened, how the community was engaged prior to this RFP going out. Because
yep.
The RFP was to lease a landfill for this activity, for this solar energy activity, is that correct?
The technical RFP went out for a proposal for an environmentally beneficial project.
Okay.
That was what the proposal was. And I think part of the reason for that is just because of the limitations on the landfill. You can't dig into that cap. So we were looking for projects that were environmentally friendly because just based on the use restrictions that the landfill imposed. My understanding was that there was very little, if no, community outreach. done before the RFP went out. And as I stated downstairs, I think we as a city didn't do a good job with that. I think that's something we need to do better, a better job of in the future. I do want to clarify just the meeting timeline just a little bit more. So after the meeting at January 6th, the Southside Task Force meeting, the applicant reached out to the Campus Dallas Civic League to have a community meeting. The original proposal was for them to attend the Campus Dallas Local Civic League meeting in February. Campus Dallas Civic League did not invite the applicant back because they felt that this project was too large and needed more time to be adequately advertised and discussed rather than just for a regular Civic League meeting. So that's why the date was moved to the 20th of March. I just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you. Any other questions for Rob or the applicant?
Well,
comments?
The issue may be located in what the community has said about who benefits. The company that is providing the know-how to install and maintain this are hooking into the grid of Dominion. And we're in a place now where solar has become very, it looks like it's a profitable and the economies are good to put it in. And the large companies, which have before this used other means to provide energy, are now working out how they're going to have some kind of profitability in this changing market of energy exchanges. So that's where we're caught right now. And traditionally, marginalized communities have not been in that discussion. So I would imagine that there should be some sensitivity about not stepping back into the old paradigm and approaching communities with the understanding that there must be clarity and there must be equity.
Yeah, and Dr. Austin, I completely agree with your points. Especially the EJ40 initiative is supposed to help benefit these communities. It's just also important to remember that this is a conditional use permit for the use. Without approving the permit, without council approving the use, there is no discussion about where those, and this is, I'm quoting Councilwoman Royster here from the meeting on Monday, there is no discussion about how to help the community. A couple of things that I think I might not have mentioned was that, anyone who subscribes to this program, and I know the opportunity is technically available to everybody, everyone who subscribes to this gets a discount on their energy bill. The applicant has agreed through multiple times now to make extraordinary effort to reach out to the members of the community as this project goes along. They've talked with Councilwoman Royster about having quarterly meetings, once the approval goes through the Internet Connect, about the jobs, about signing up. And when the subscriptions are about to go live, they're planning on sending out mailers through the community and other methods to try to make sure that these residents who have been marginalized who have had to live next to this landfill and in the community for so long have the opportunity to subscribe first. One of the other things that the applicant has agreed to is to help fund a robotics team at the STEM school in Campostella. They're setting up a fund so that program can last, so that program, I don't believe there is one now, or if there is one, can begin operation or continue operation for 10 years or so. And again, I think, as we've gone through this process, we've been involved in this since September or so. I don't blame the community for being frustrated about not knowing where the funds are going to be distributed. You're talking about a large sum of money that, City Council hasn't really discussed yet. And I think not reaching out to the community before the RFP went out was a mistake, and one I hope we don't repeat for any future RFPs.
Isn't it usually in these kinds of cases that the benefit is in the of what it will cost to get the energy, because there should be some benefit, and we've talked about that, as to people getting back monies, their bills are better, they don't have to struggle as much. Now, I've heard it talks of stocks and bonds and whatnot. That is an issue that needs to be discussed within the community, because it doesn't necessarily, that doesn't apply in this kind of situation where the issue is making energy available at a cheaper rate. So
The issue that we're dealing with is a land use issue.
Exactly.
And to Ms. Shelton's point, if there are things that are important to the community, those should be discussed before a request for proposal goes out, and so that those items can be included in the request for proposal. And rather than asking a proposer to change what they've proposed after the fact, when they've already crunched the numbers and said, this is what we can do based on what you're asking. But for us, we're dealing with a land use issue, and the city will be collecting rent for the use of this land, and how they choose to distribute that money throughout the community will be decided by city council. And I know the two representatives whose ward this is within are very in tune to the money that'll be collected from the rent. Commissioners, any comments or questions for Rob or the applicant?
I have a question for the applicant. Ms. Boots, is that
yes.
correct? Yep. So have you met with the two Civic League leaders that are here today individually?
Not individually, no.
Why not, I guess, is the question.
Sure, yeah. At the January meeting, I was sick and unable to attend. So that's why Mike Burkowski, the president of Community Power Group, came down and gave a presentation. Maybe he was a little less prepared because I had called out sick that morning. I met Ms. Hendrick at Monday's meeting, gave her my card, look forward to continuing conversations with her, and, you know, open to collaborating on how to provide more information. You know, we did distribute a 4-page FAQ, and the breakout sessions, all the questions were gathered and are being distributed to everyone who attended. But we're happy to hold another meeting before City Council, but we would just ask that there's a vote today to continue it to City Council.
So on that note, I can think of a lot of benefits of more discussion with the community, perhaps over the next 30 days. What are the negative consequences of continuing this application that we might not be considering at this point?
I don't think there's any negative consequences besides the potential of further delays and the losing of the capacity for the community solar program. Quicker.
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Sorry. The community solar program, it does have a cap of 150 megawatts for the state, and that was opened, I believe, in 2021. So projects are actively eating up that capacity, and we really want this project to be able to benefit from that, because otherwise it would only be a 3-megawatt project.
There's the 30 continuation for 30 days that it requested. How does that affect this?
Just a month later that we might be able to apply.
May I add something? So just for clarification, there's a 150 megawatt cap statewide.
For community solar.
For community solar. This project is going to take up about 8 megawatts total.
I thought it was eight.
So it's five. Okay. Simultaneously, there's other projects going on all around the state. And as they get approved, it eats away at the 150.
That's understood.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's this unknown timeline. We just know we want to try to get it as soon as possible, or we miss out on this opportunity.
That's correct. And, you know, I don't think 30 days maybe isn't going to get the last 5 megawatts gone, but the open continuation, you know, what's to prevent another 30 days or city council from delaying as well. But I guess we would I'd like to continue if that's, you know, the way this seems to be going. We can continue 1 month and ask that the council or the Civic League presidents provide direct instructions on how they would like the information shared, because we've exhausted the known efforts to this date.
I sort of take issue with your last comment. So you said you've exhausted the known methods to date, but you haven't even met with the Civic League leaders. Like, you said the word collaboration earlier. Collaboration is a meeting where two parties come together and discuss issues.
Meetings already and sent out 2,000 mailers to all the neighborhoods.
But you characterized one meeting as the person from your agency was not as well prepared as they should have been.
I'm just saying I was sick and someone had to cover for me.
I can't understand what you're saying.
I was sick that day and someone had to cover for me.
Okay, so the thing is that it seems to be clear at this point what needs to be done, and that can be done with all speed to move the project where it should be. That means meetings with the people who need to be met with, clarity in presentation, and then decisions and moving on.
Yes, 100% agree. I do feel like we've put a lot of effort into that, as Rob has said, but like I'm saying right now, we're agreeing to the 30-day continuance. We'll have at least one meeting with Ms. Hendrick and Mr.
Brown.
Mr. Brown and Ms. Hendrick, we will have at least one meeting with them in the next 30 days. I know that scheduling the March 20th meeting, like Rob had mentioned, did take a while. We intended for February. That's why we asked to be removed from the February agenda and to continue to today so that we could have that March meeting. So
March isn't over, so it's possible to still get together.
Yeah, no, absolutely. In the next 30 days.
Okay. What I'm hearing is that there seems to be general agreement that that this is a good project and probably a good use of the land. It seems that there have been enough mistakes or shortcomings to go around, and I don't want to feel like we're just beating you up, because, again, I could take issue. Someone said, I hope this doesn't happen again. There's a pattern of this, and there's another landfill that I know is being discussed right now and not with the community. And that is an error that we need to correct on future projects. But at this point, I think the chair would entertain a motion to continue this item for until next month so that the applicant can meet with the community again and hopefully answer all questions over the next 30 days. So that this is a very quick agenda item at our next public hearing. And that was a long motion, I'm sorry.
I am more than happy to make this motion, but I want to add one thing to it, which is not binding. So many of the questions that you all have, and again, having been very familiar with RFP processes, that you have of this applicant is not in the position to answer, because the answers have to come from the city of Norfolk, the decision makers in the city of Norfolk. We are the decision makers on the land use. We're the recommenders on the land use. We're still not the decision makers. But we are not the recommenders nor the decision makers on what happens to funds that come into a city lease. And I know you all know this. What I want to do is, and I'm happy to make this motion, I want to make sure that the people who can answer those questions, or at least give you, I know the city can't promise under budgeted funds. That's not legal. But I want to make sure that if we burn 30 days potentially and have some, if any, potential effect on your ability to get into that solar program, that we are doing it and it's diligently being pursued by the decision makers of the city as who can answer those questions. This is a city lease. This is a company that was chosen through a competitive RFP process. It was a negotiated lease. We're here on the land use piece of it. Where that money goes is not with us. I really want to thank you all for coming down here today. And I do think it's a good project and it's a good land use. But I would like to make a motion that we continue this project for 30 days.
this decision for 30
and
days.
And I'd like to second it. Before I do, I wanted to make a statement as well.
You're
wrong. I recognize that this is a decision on land use, but we're very particular about the folks that live near that land and how they're respected and how they feel about it. I'll speak for the South Side because I live there too. And I believe we're a very loving and wonderful group of people, and we want to embrace the future. I think somewhere in the city, the South Side is considered one of the neighborhoods of the future. So we're not being obstinate. We just want to make sure that we're respected and we're included. And I think you've probably witnessed how we haven't been in the past. So we just want to be sure that Community Solar isn't continuing in that pattern. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
I think that at this point, we're open, obviously, the Civic League representatives that are here are open to having that conversation and a productive conversation for all parties. And somehow, collectively, we'll get to an enthusiastic yes. So I second the motion.
Great. Properly moved and seconded. Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is continue the item till your meeting on April 27th. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutterth?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. We'll see you in 30 days. Appreciate everyone for coming down today. Moving on to the regular agenda.
Okay. Item number one on the regular agenda, City Planning Commission for Zoning Text Amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance for Outdoor Dining on Private Property.
Rob left me a lot of slides to go through here. Okay, good afternoon, commissioners. So this is an item, as Susan mentioned, to revise the requirements for the outdoor seating accessory use in the zoning ordinance. The current accessory use standards are outdated. They date from the 2018 zoning ordinance. We've learned quite a lot since then. There's also a lot of where we learned was we created in 2020, we created a temporary use during the pandemic to provide additional outdoor seating opportunities because people weren't able to eat inside restaurants at the same capacity as they were before. So we learned a lot. We need to incorporate that in. We also need to remove those pandemic temporary conditions and incorporate some things into the permanent accessory use. So the current zoning requirements, we have an accessory use called outdoor seating as accessory to an eating and drinking use. So this would be outdoor seating accessory to outside of a restaurant, outside of a craft beverages establishment, nightclub, that type of location. The current use is, like I said, it's a little outdated. It only addresses on-site areas. It does not permit anything within a parking lot, though. So that is one of the things that we've seen a lot of since the pandemic is businesses operating outdoor seating areas within their parking areas. So that's something that is not currently permitted. There's a few other things that just need to be clarified a little bit more. I won't go into the full detail on them. So in 2020, we created what we called a set of pandemic emergency temporary uses. One of those was to permit specifically permit outdoor seating in parking areas. It was already happening as part of the Open Norfolk program because we were endeavoring to get restaurants back into business. And so we created this temporary use that was permitted during the pandemic emergency. That pandemic emergency, as per City Council, expires the end of April, so next month. The permissions were a little bit different. It allowed outdoor seating in parking areas was the biggest thing. It had different hours of operation than the standard use did. So there's a few things that need to be corrected there. So the proposal here would be to delete the pandemic temporary outdoor seating use. It's no longer relevant in a month. And then to rewrite the outdoor seating areas, apply it to possibilities for on-site parking areas. Make clear the current permanent accessory use. That's awkward, but the current use it's unclear that it applies to on-site as well as it does seem to apply to areas of the right-of-way. That's zoning doesn't do that. So we want to correct that as well. We do, and I apologize, there's some outdated language here. In suburban and coastal areas, we want to essentially permit outdoor seating in parking lots. You're required to have parking. If you have parking above and beyond what you're required to have, we want to allow you to go ahead and utilize those additional parking spaces for outdoor seating. In downtown and traditional character districts, so more into closer to downtown, we would propose that the existing on-site parking be permitted to be used, but only 30% of that without a conditional use permit. With a conditional use permit, you could go above and beyond that. We also want to be clear that the amplified music can't take place after 10 p.m. Any amplified music outdoor cannot take place after 10 p.m. in these areas, and that these areas could not be used at all past 11 p.m. Too many of them are adjacent to residential to allow that as a by right condition. Again, that's something we also would be clear that could be modified through a conditional use permit. There are cases where it might well be appropriate. And that, I believe, is all I have on this one, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions for Jeremy? I'll say my comment now rather than waiting until I vote. I'm going to vote against any recommendation that prioritizes parking over people, and I think that active uses such as outdoor dining are much better use of land than parking. Any other comments, commissioners? Thank you. Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the zoning text amendment for outdoor dining on private property. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye, but I do think we need to revisit this at some point and continue refining it.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye, and I agree. We need to revisit this pretty quickly.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote no, and I'll make that recommendation to City Council. Item two, please.
All right, so next item.
City Planning Commission for zoning text amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance for commercial drive-through small scale in the DAD Downtown Arts District.
All right, so now the next item, again, as mentioned, this would be an amendment to permit small-scale commercial drive-throughs in the Downtown Arts District Zoning District. Just to clarify, a small-scale drive-through is anything that's not a restaurant and not more than one lane. So if you have a restaurant drive-through, it's automatically a large-scale drive-through not covered under this. If you have multiple lanes, say a bank drive-through with multiple lanes, not covered under this. It's one lane, non-restaurant. The use is permitted currently by right in several other downtown districts, all of our commercial districts, various other districts around the city. So the proposal, let me go through the bullet points here. So many businesses have adapted to the pandemic by establishing outdoor dining, as we just mentioned, but drive-through facilities to service their clientele, their customers. There has been a request to do so in the Downtown Arts District. The district does not permit that. And so we did want to bring this forward to be considered. So again, the use small scale drive-through use, and I discussed the size of the definition. So the proposed amendments here would be to allow drive-through small scale in the Downtown Arts District, but as what we call a P/C use. So permitted in some cases, conditional use permit in other cases. The reason we want to do this is we do want to be, the Arts District was created with pedestrian quality in mind, and we don't want to damage that. We don't want to harm that. So we want to be very cautious about where something like this is approved. So the condition that we would put in where a conditional use permit would be required would be that wherever the drive-through is not accessory to a single tenant building 50,000 square feet or larger. So the thinking here is large single tenant office buildings that might have found a reason to utilize a drive-through facility to serve some of their customers. It's going to be secondary. It's going to be clearly secondary. If you're talking a smaller building with a drive-through, that might be a significant component of their business. We think this is enough of a reason, enough of a distinction to limit the number that are permitted by right, allow the use, allow them to operate. But the bulk of anybody wanting to do something significant here would be require that conditional use permit. And with that, I think I'm here for any questions.
Great. Questions for Jeremy? Please stand by. Here to speak in support of this application is Denise Gallup.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Denise Gallup. My address would be 741 Monticello Avenue, and that is the Department of Human Services. The purpose for, and I currently serve as the director of that department and proud to do so. Just so you know a little bit about Human Services, we serve over 108,000 of Norfolk's most vulnerable citizens. And these are individuals who are at risk for abuse and neglect. They're at risk for continuing to be in a cycle of poverty and at risk for all other type of ailments that you can imagine. So when the pandemic hit for us, we had to continue to do business even though the world had shifted. As a matter of fact, we ended up doing more business than we had ever done before. What we found out, and we were very excited to know, is that most of everything that we can easily do virtually. We administer benefits for all public assistance programs, and they can all be done via computer. In addition to that, we do services programs, abuse, neglect, those types of things, and we do specific work with those customers in the community. We had about 5 different office locations at that time, at the very beginning of the pandemic, and we had to reduce to 1 building. So all 500 or so employees, that would be the permanent station for them. And as you can imagine, we don't necessarily have enough room to be able to have all of our employees in the building at the same time, nor all of the customers that we serve into the building at the same time. We're doing some great renovations to our property right now, adding things that just make sense for the population that we serve, to include this drive-through window. What that would do is we'll complete our 3-prong approach to serving our customers. Customers who love technology, who don't struggle with that, they get right online, they submit their applications, they provide the verifications, and then we do what we do, and all of that is done online. We have a group of people who they just have to come to the building. They don't know if we will get their application and we will stamp it correctly unless they literally put it in our hands. And we certainly encourage that for people who want to do it. But what this option would do would allow those individuals who, yeah, they want to drop it off to the building, but they're not really trying to come inside. Because of course, although COVID issues have reduced some, they, for the population that we serve, it is still a very challenging disease to try to combat. And so individuals would be able to drive through our window, and literally they will be able to either drop off their applications, they will be able to provide their verifications, and or they would be able to pick up their EBT card, which is the card that is used for their SNAP benefits. So that's why we're here before you today. It is, we will be the only Department of Human Services in the region and maybe even in the state that offers this type of approach to the people we serve. We've been downtown since 2006. I don't know if people just didn't realize what happened in that particular building, but we believe our customers should have a right to come to the downtown district just like every other customer. We're neighbors with Bob's Gun Shop. In many cases, they use our area to take pretty pictures of the mural that's on the wall. And so we want to be good partners, but we also know that what we do is really important for those who are vulnerable. So those are my comments.
Thank you very much. Don't wander too far.
I won't.
We don't have anybody signed up to speak against the application. Do we have any questions for staff or for Ms. Gallup? Because Ms. Gallup is in the building. She's not the applicant per se. I've got one. That's why I asked you to stay. How many cars a day are we talking about?
Maybe 10 to 15. And usually our high period of issuance is anywhere between the third of the month and the eighth of the month.
Right.
And most of the activity will happen during that process. We also have some mobile vehicles that we're excited about, mobile offices where we're going into communities and helping people who are just disconnected from being able to get to the department. And we believe that that will also help us in this time.
Great. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Yes.
I have a comment, of course. I just want to say, while you're here in front of us, I want to really thank you and the department for becoming very customer focused and customer centers. You know, we see that from Nordstrom, right? But it's so wonderful to see that for those who deal with our most vulnerable citizens. And as a mom who used to have little kids in a car and not having to take them out of a car to walk in to do something real quick, because we're not leaving our kids in cars, y'all, anymore. We were raised that way. We don't raise our kids that way. So I do want to just say thank you so much for being innovative and the department for being innovative in serving the people of Norfolk. So I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Well, sometimes circumstances allows us to adopt things that we wouldn't have thought of before.
Yes, ma'am.
So out of the pandemic came something positive.
Absolutely.
And we should think about that in terms of other things that may come up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think you're good. Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the zoning text amendment for commercial drive-through small scale in the DAD Downtown Arts District. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council, and thank you very much for the work you do. Thank you.
Item number 3, Electrified Marina LLC for a conditional use permit to allow boat sales, rental service, or repair at 1525 and 1540 Bayville Street. The purpose of this request is to allow boat sales, rental service, or repair.
Thank you, Susan. This project is in the Willoughby Marina on the south side of I-64 at the west end of Willoughby. It's almost as far as you can go in the city limits. The proposed use does not conflict with the future land use map of Plan Norfolk 2030, which allocates the site as commercial. It is currently zoned CC. In this district, if you are adjacent to the water doing boat rentals, you need a conditional use permit. So here are some photos of the site. I had a photo for you at the mid-month that had a picture of a bigger picture of the whole site, but it got corrupted and I didn't have time to update it. So I did want to point out that this is the building on the left-hand side that the actual office would be in. And then on the right-hand side of your screen, you see the landscaping that currently exists between the marina and Bayville Street. That landscaping will be enhanced as a condition of approval. They will have a 2-year time limit to do that because there are negotiations ongoing about purchasing the marina and renovating, doing a complete renovation of it. So that 2-year time window should give them time to complete that transaction, bring the whole marina renovation through site plan, and get the appropriate landscaping within that 2-year period. The use does not conflict with the future land use map nor the goals of Plan Norfolk 2030. And the use is located at Marina. So staff is recommending approval of the application subject to conditions. All personal watercraft rented shall be battery-powered electric engine propulsion. So those are the jet skis. The company is primarily focused on selling and renting electric vehicles, electric boats, electric jet skis. So the One of the requirements in our performance standards states that all underwater personal motorcraft must have a muffler system. The electric jet skis don't need that. I'll let the applicant talk to you more about that, but I did upload their video for you guys regarding the jet skis. The rental personal watercraft, on the slide it says dawn to dusk. We edited the conditions. The last minute they say from 6:30 to 8. 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. 6 a.m. to 8:30 p.m. The enhanced landscaping along Bayville Street within 2 years. And a review of all federal, state, local, and marina-specific navigation rules and restrictions with each renter. There are other operators on the site. That requirement will have the applicant, the whoever does the renting of the equipment, to go over the no-go zones, the no-wake zones, and how to navigate the into and out of the marina separately, as to not interrupt and cause problems for the other actors. I stand by for any questions.
Thanks, Rob. Questions for Rob. All right, please stand by. We have two people signed up to speak as the applicant, Aaron Gatling and Charity Day. Would either or both of you like to speak?
Hey there, I'm Aaron Gatling, owner of Electrified Marina, 619 Bridge Street.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. We are very passionate about electric vehicles. They are silent, so there's no noise pollution. There's no smell. We would like to be able to show people in the community from the water side, which is a lot of the community doesn't get the opportunity to see the city from the water side. So this will give anyone in the public the ability to come out and see it on our electric boats and personal watercraft. Rob did a good job, so I don't have a whole lot to add, but I'm here to answer any questions you may have.
Great. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
I had a question for you.
Certainly.
I know that particular bay area you share with the other side is the Naval Base,
mm-hmm.
And they have lots of craft that go in and out there. Have you had any conversation with the Navy about maneuvering? And obviously, there's lots of construction going on there right now, so hopefully that won't be there
correct.
Forever.
Correct, yeah. I have not yet directly spoken to them about the go-no-go zones. I was hoping to get through the approval, which mandates that we need to create the no-go zones that everyone agrees on. Those will be published online as well as a part of the required training before people go out.
I've gone out there, and it looks very amenable to what service you want to do in light of the way that everything is structured and the site is planned. It looks like it's conducive to your project.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. Please stand by. Ms. Day, anything you'd like to add? Thanks for coming. And we have one individual signed up to speak in support of the application, Bob Layton.
I'm Bob Layton, 1501 Bayville Street. That is the east side contiguous residential property to the site. I'm here to ask that you support and pass this request. I am convinced it will produce some much-needed investment in the site. I also want to thank you for your service. I particularly want to thank Rob for his patience in leading us down a somewhat torturous path, because this is the really first run-out of the new zoning code against the marina use. And as with all new zoning codes, there are places that could be tweaked a little bit. I will close with that. I know how much time this job takes from you guys, and this night you might get home in time for dinner. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Layton. And while we're handing it out, thank yous, I'd like to thank you for the time you spent serving on Planning Commission. There are no opposition to this application. Any comments from the commissioners? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutterth?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thanks. We'll make that recommendation to City Council.
Item number 4, A, B, and B, Federal Credit Union for a conditional use permit for drive-through facility, large scale at 129 West Little Creek Road and 110 Burley Avenue. The purpose of the request is to allow the bank to operate a drive-through.
Thank you, Susan. This property is located on the south side of West Little Creek Road between Colonial Avenue and Granby Street. The proposed use is consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates the site as commercial. It is currently zoned CC, Community Commercial. And in this district, you are required to get a conditional use permit to operate a drive-through facility large scale. Here we have a photo of the front of the site. The site previously operated as SunTrust Bank from the 1980s until 2020. It closed in 2020, and the new applicant, AB&B Federal Credit Union, is looking to go into that new space. Since their use permit was discontinued for 2 years, they need a new CUP. They were also triggered in this process because they are spending more than 50% of the assessed value of the structure, which brings them through the CUP process. On the left-hand side of your screen, you can see the area looking, if you were standing at where you would park your car, looking back towards Burley Avenue. You can see they have a good amount of landscaping on the left-hand side of your screen there, which is part of their performance standard requirement. And then on the right-hand side of your screen, you can see where my car, was parked as if it was gonna go through the drive-through. You can also see there on the right-hand side of your screen that there's a large gray blank wall. I'm gonna get into that in a second, but that was part of one of the community's concerns regarding this project. So looking at their proposed site plan, our transit department recommended the installation of an ADA curb ramp at the crosswalk. So that will go across West Little Creek Road there. The community voiced three concerns. One, that the exterior security lights of the building were not functioning, that the interior parking lot lights were not on at all times, and that they wanted to see a mural painted on that wall there. The applicant has agreed to all three of those conditions. They're going to repair those exterior security lights. They're going to keep those exterior security lights and the parking lot lights on from dusk to dawn. And they're going to paint a mural on the eastern facade. They've requested that they get a 6-month timeline from the time they get their business license to paint that mural. That will give them time to find a local artist and to have a grand unveiling of the mural when they're open. Given that the location is a heavily auto-oriented commercial corridor where drive-thrus are common, and the site was previously a financial institution with the drive-through, staff recommends approval, subject to the conditions. The ADA curb ramp being installed, the exterior security lights being repaired, and the parking lot lights being repaired and staying on dusk to dawn, and the mural. I stand by for any questions.
Thanks, Rob. Any questions for Rob? Okay, the applicant's here to signed up to speak. We actually have two individuals signed up as the applicant. We have Mark Ricketts and Jody Love. Would either or both of you like to speak? Name and mailing address, please.
Absolutely.
Thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Mark Ricketts. I'm with AES Consulting Engineers. Our address is 816 Greenbrier Circle in Chesapeake. And with me is an officer of AB&B, Ms. Jody Love. And we're here, and in the interest of brevity, I think Rob covered it very well. We coordinated with the city staff. I attended the meeting with the Civic League where they brought up those issues. We ran them past AB&B Federal Credit Union. Everybody was amenable to it, so we certainly agreed to the conditions. So with that, we'll stand by for any questions that you may have.
Thank you. Commissioners, any questions? Please call the vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Yes.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. Thank you both for taking the time to come down here today, and we'll make that recommendation to City Council.
Thank you. Skipping to item number 6, Mama Atura for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit vacation rental at 9660 Ralston Street. The purpose of this request is to allow the single-family home to operate as a short-term rental.
All right. So this is for a conditional use permit, operating short-term rental, vacation rental, in a 5-bedroom single-family home on the east side of Ralston Street, adjacent to I-64 in the Willoughby neighborhood. A A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes Coastal Character District as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. Plan Norfolk 2030 also designates this site as residential mixed. Property is zoned residential coastal. All short-term rentals in this zone with more than 3 bedrooms are required to have a CUP to operate. So here you see the site for the proposed short-term rental. The house was built in 2022 on a 28,000 square foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements. The applicant will be planting one more tree in the backyard to come more into compliance with the required 20% tree canopy. The home is already in compliance with flood regulations. For other short-term rentals nearby, there are currently 24 vacation short-term rentals, 2 homestay short-term rentals, for a total of 26 registered short-term rental parcels within a 1-mile radius. An additional 5 short-term rentals are pending. We are currently tracking 19 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area, but this property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there's currently 1 registered vacation short-term rental with 1 additional pending, and we are currently tracking 4 additional non-registered short-term rentals. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 80% of parcels are residential, 4.7% or 26 of those are short-term rentals. Nearly 90% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, 1.4% or 1 of those is a short-term rental. Including this application, if all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 5.7% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. There is no map for comments, as I did not receive any. The staff is recommending approval subject to the conditions. The standard conditions include having emergency contact provided inside and outside of each unit, maintaining the 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, private trash pickup. Applicant will plant a rear yard tree, and the CUP will expire in 2 years. Any questions?
Any questions? The applicant is here. Please stand by. No. Mamet Tura is the applicant. Thank you. I'm sorry, you checked that you did not wish to speak. I didn't mean to call you up here if you don't want to speak. But if you'd like to tell us about your application, please.
Normally, I don't want to speak if you don't have any questions, but I can answer if you have a question.
Why don't you give us your name and mailing address, and then we'll open it up for questions.
My name is Mamet Tura. Mailing address 540 Furman Court, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23462.
Great. Well, welcome to Planning Commission. Do we have any questions for the applicant?
I do. Who will be who's the property manager for the property?
We agreed with the Boardwalk Realty. They are working in this neighborhood, so we agreed with Jan
Hedgecockers.
Yes, the property manager, the professional company.
Any other questions? There is no opposition. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Yes.
Mr. McGee?
Yes.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye and will make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you.
Item number 8, Legacy Restaurant and Bar for the following conditional use permits at 216 East Plume Street. A, restaurant with the sale of alcoholic beverages on premises and the sale of alcoholic beverages off premises. Okay, the applicant is Legacy, as I had indicated. They are located at 216 East Plume Street, and that's East Plume Street between Granby and Atlantis. The proposal is to allow for the restaurant to sell alcoholic beverages for on and off-premise consumption. The site is located in the DBC, which is the Downtown Business Center District, and a conditional use permit is required for the sale of alcoholic beverages for both on and off-premise. So just to give you a history of the site, on August 24th, 2021, a conditional use permit was granted to Legacy to operate a nightclub. On August 5th, 2022, 4 people were shot outside of the facility by a patron of the facility. It's about 23 days later. On September 13, 2022, City Council revoked the conditional use permit based on that incident. September 22, 2022, Legacy appealed the council's decision to the Circuit Court. They also made a motion for a preliminary injunction, which would have allowed Legacy to continue to operate as a nightclub until the appeal was heard by the court. On October 5th, 2022, the preliminary injunction was denied. On December 9th, 2022, Legacy withdrew the appeal. They do have until May 9th to refile. On January 17th, the applicant then applied for and was approved for a restaurant zoning certificate. The zoning certificate allowed them to operate without entertainment, without alcohol, and closing by midnight. Pretty shortly after that, on February 3rd, the applicant submitted a CUP application, which is this application, which would allow them to have alcohol. So that's just a history of the site. This is their floor plan. It is almost exactly the same as it was when it was a nightclub. They, if you look at the left-hand side of the floor plan, kind of right next to the door, that was where the dance floor was. It now says occupancy, so there would be people standing there versus it being a dance floor. Just to give you an idea of when they received the conditional use permit, what they had versus what they are requesting now. So the hours of operation before were from 8 o'clock a.m. until 2 o'clock a.m. 7 days a week. What they are proposing is 8 o'clock a.m. until 12 o'clock midnight 7 days a week. The next two, again, entertainment. They are not requesting that entertainment be included in this application. You see here there's two occupancies. They had one for the restaurant, one for the nightclub. Again, they're not asking for a nightclub, so the capacity is essentially the same. They had 108 before, they've got 110 now, and I would assume they would have the same queue line in the case of people lining up to get into the establishment. It went alongside the building, and if needed, up the stairs. So that would remain in place. As I mentioned before, staff spent quite a bit of time considering this application. But the facts, you know, again, January 13, the applicant received a business license to operate. Just over 3 weeks later, 23 days, August 25th, the very serious incident occurred, which caused the City Council to revoke the conditional use permit. The applicant did then obtain a restaurant zoning certificate to operate as a restaurant with no entertainment or alcohol. The applicant had only been in operation for about 18 days before applying for that CUP that you have in front of you to add back the alcohol. Upon review of the application, the operational characteristics are essentially the same as those in place when they had that incident. The managers are the same managers that they had then, are the same managers that they're requesting. They are asking for one additional staff member. I think it's a new chef. As I indicated, the floor plan is essentially the same. Before they had security, they were required to have security because they had entertainment. When people don't have entertainment, they're not required to have security. However, again, when they had the incident, it wasn't operating as a nightclub. It was operating with a restaurant, with alcohol, and they did have security, and yet we still had the incident. And again, they did not have entertainment that night. Again, they're not requesting entertainment under this application. So as proposed, the operation of the establishment, we feel, is really a continuation of the previous operation. And staff is concerned that the applicant has not fully addressed prior issues or significantly modified the operational aspects of the establishment to warrant approval of the conditional use permit at this time. We do understand that the applicant is working with the Downtown Norfolk Council to be a part of the Safe Nights program. And that's a program that the goal is to make all establishments in downtown be safer. However, that program is not in place yet. They are working diligently. They are doing training right now, but it is not in place yet. So we do hope that the applicant would take part of that, would get approval. You get a gold star once you get through that program, but they're not there yet. So again, because of these reasons, staff cannot support this request as it is proposed. Any questions?
Thanks, Susan. Any questions? Please stand by. The applicant is here to speak. Warren Zalvadon.
How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm fine. My name is Warren Salvadon. I live at 5330 Kendallwood Drive, Virginia Beach, Virginia. There's a couple of things that she stated that was not accurate. For the night of the incident, there was security that night. We had it on film. We weren't allowed to show our film, and they put a protective order, so we couldn't show how security operated in a professional manner. In the event of that incident, one of our managers took it upon himself after seeing that security couldn't handle the whole situation, and he was the bigger person, so he intervened to take that person off of him. Even though he did it a little bit forcefully, he did what he thought was the best effort to get that person off the premises. That's what we tried to prove in all our hearings. No one wanted to hear it, couldn't show it, couldn't show the news, couldn't do anything. So we just went through our cases and took whatever they gave us, because all we can do. And that's the honest truth. If y'all want to see the video, we can show you the video also for that incident that happened that night. So you can see we did operate in a professional manner. We did not operate as a, our restaurant hours was from 5 to 9. It was 1 o'clock when the incident happened. So we were operating as a nightclub, not a restaurant. So we still had security even while we had a restaurant time frame also, because we had alcohol and we knew we were going into a nightclub time frame. So security comes in, they trickle in. It was like one person every hour until 10 o'clock, and then all of the security guards are there at the whole time from 10 to 2. And at that time, even on Thursdays, at that time, we only operated until, I think it was 12 o'clock on Thursdays at the time of the incident, but we ended up staying there because of the shooting that happened. That person, it was an alcohol-related offense that we found that we were responsible for in accordance with the investigation that ABC did. There was no violations, so it wasn't alcohol-related. It was the fact that I think his pride was hurt, that he got tossed out of a venue, and he retaliated in the way he did, which was not something I thought we would be responsible for, which now I realize that the city held us responsible for it. So as men, we hold ourselves accountable for the incident that did happen, even though there were things that we did in the process to get help. We called Norfolk PD. They took a while to get there. By the time they got there, he was already at his car, and then he fired rounds and hit one of the police officers themselves. Not something we can control. He walked all the way to his vehicle to have this situation done. So that's just to explain some of the things that she just said that was inaccurate, that we couldn't actually fight. Could we put it all in the lawyer's hands? And what he was fighting for was just the fact that to prove that it was going to cause irreparable harm for us not to be open and operating while we wait for an actual conviction, I want to say, something like that. And it did cause irreparable harm, because right now we're struggling to pay everything because we were closed for 5 months. It did. I mean, we can't sell alcohol, which is a balance to your sales. It helps when people aren't hungry, when people just want a beverage. You know, so that's why we ask for on and off premises alcohol, so that we can actually utilize the tools as Uber Eats, Grubhub, and things like that to increase sales with alcohol going out as well as food. So that's another resource that we use. That was just to go after the stuff she said. I'm not sure how much time I have, but I did write something down.
You're the applicant. Your time is not limited.
That was something completely. I wrote this in the morning time, so it was good morning, but now it's good good evening, public officials. My name is Warren Salvadon, and this is my partner, Alexander Stokes, and we are the owners of Legacy Lounge, applying for our conditional use permit to sell alcohol on and off premises while operating as a restaurant. We are aware of many controversies that sparked the ears and minds around our business due to an altercation that happened, leading to our conditional use permit and many other businesses being revoked. My partner and I have decided to reopen as a restaurant at this time, in which we have been operating successfully since February 10th without issue. Our management and small team have been trained properly as food managers, food handlers, and serve safe certified personnel, which is the only requirement that's needed. All our management team have taken a management class and have also taken the state regulated ABC MART certification class, Managers Alcohol Responsibility Training, to get a better understanding of how to deal with the proper sale of alcohol and how to deal with the customers who consume it. Our waitress and bartender staff were also required to take another ABC course called RSVP, Responsible Seller and Servers Virginia Program, before they can serve alcohol to any patrons in our business. Legacy Lounge has also joined the efforts of downtown Norfolk to keep the city safe by being one of the three companies that are involved. No, it's voluntary. It's not a program that everyone has to do, even though it says for all restaurants. The Safe Night program is voluntary, so a lot of people don't have to join it. That we were told the best interest is for us to join it, which we would have did anyway before we even got revocation of our cut process, knowing that an incident of that, you know, that statute had happened. So. Legacy Lounge has also joined the efforts of downtown Norfolk to keep the city safe by being one of the three companies to join Norfolk's new Safe Night program, with hopes that this leads to our venue developing more trust with the city and better relationships with surrounding businesses and its many residents. Norfolk allowing us to be a part of this program and help with its structural plan development while in the beta stages gives my partner and I the hopes that this is another step towards us eventually being able to operate as what we have always planned to do, which was to be a lounge for people who just want to have a good time and go home safe, having sweet dreams about how they cannot wait to return the legacy for a memorable time. My partner and I have changed our whole way of operation within Legacy Restaurant and have done this with the same management team by conducting more training and by doing weekly reviews on how our staff operate. This allows for us to figure out our strengths and weaknesses in the business and take... and take corrective action to have smoother operation. Like any new business, there have been many things we have encountered and are thankful we have, because it allows us to learn from them, like many other businesses have been able to do time and time again before us. While we operated as a nightclub before, we are not doing so now. We have an earlier opening and closing time, an extensive menu, and present an all rhythm and blues atmosphere. Our marketing platforms only promote great tasting food and amazing non-alcoholic beverages at this time, such as our mocktails. While we realize customers love our food and the reviews will tell you that alone, the sales of our food in a city with not much foot traffic or available parking anymore is difficult. Therefore, us needing to sell alcohol is a must in order for us to stay above water and also be competitive is why we come to you today asking for your approval. While food is what's pushed daily through our marketing platforms, it's the great taste of alcoholic beverages crafted by charismatic bartenders is what a lot of customers are looking for after a long day's work and have turned around and left the business because we have not been able, I apologize, what I was stating was that because we do not have the alcohol to sell, for some patrons who do want an alcoholic beverage, it's a loss of a sale every time when people turn around. So, and we have to acknowledge that. So today we are asking that we are able to get your approval to sell alcohol beverages to our customers and also find time in our day to come try a meal. And also for you guys to come try, find time in your day to come try a meal so that you can see what all the hype is about. Thank you for your time. That was all I had.
Great. Thank you very much.
I'm going real fast reading this.
Super. While you're up here, I'll ask the commissioners if they have any questions.
I just had a question because I want to understand the timeline for you went for a preliminary injunction to the circuit court, and that was denied.
Yes, sir.
And you have until May 9th to appeal that. So is this a...
Let me clarify that because okay. I think that's just a technical legal question.
Yes, I was going to ask you.
After the preliminary injunction denial, I learned from Legacy's attorney who was handling the case at the time that they were going to non-suit the case, and that's just lawyer speak for withdraw the case. And under Virginia law, which is the right of any plaintiff to take a non-suit, a completely unilateral right to do that. And under Virginia law, any case that's non-suited can be brought back again, but it has to be brought back within 6 months or within the statute of limitations. And here, the 6 months is the longer period of time. So if they'd like to bring back their appeal of the city council's revocation of their CUP, they could conceivably bring that case back. I have not heard from their attorney. I don't believe that's going to happen. I just wanted to make sure your packet was clear that if they wanted to bring that challenge back, they have until May to do that.
Anything you all want to add to that answer, which I think was technically very clear, but
no, we don't have a plan on coming back after the city.
Good, there we go. Thank you. Any other questions?
I have another question.
Okay. The Safe Night program, how long is it from? I guess I know it's in its beta phases, but what is the anticipated length of the program before you complete it?
That's the point right now. Like so when the city revoked us, I guess they went ahead and tried to find another method of how to help the city out. So they called in a company who took maybe 4 months to, are you going to answer?
They're still forming the program.
Yeah.
Okay. They can't even go through it until they've formed the program.
I see.
But they are utilizing us, they're utilizing us, Brothers and Baxter's. They gave us their better program, and they told us to incorporate our whole business plan, our whole operational procedures into it. And then they also came and sat with us and asked us what do we think can be changed, what things, because, you know, being that we went through the incident, we're allowed to tell them what needs to be changed, what things we should incorporate, what things we think are different. Like, they have a lot of things in there that shouldn't be responsible of restaurants, and we're defending that, such as health administration stuff, like if a person passes out with allergic reaction or something, that now the restaurant is responsible for doing medicine, providing medicine and stuff like that. That's not stuff that should be in our lane that can cause us to have issues. So we're defending stuff like that. This is not hard for us to go through this whole process. It's really a simple process. A lot of the stuff that's in the accreditation program, we've already done. Once the incident happened, we immediately got told from ABC, these are things you should do moving forward. We also took it upon ourselves to retrain and do things over. We're both two military men. We know how to do things, I mean, by procedures and practices. It's not what we're in trouble for or what we had gotten in trouble for. And so, again, we're holding ourselves accountable, even though we fought to prove our case. We don't feel like everything went smooth, but at the end of the day, we're holding ourselves accountable and trying to start over. That's why we didn't ask for entertainment. We didn't ask for anything right now. We're starting back from a restaurant that has the ability to sell alcohol like everyone else, just so we can be competitive with our people around us. That's it.
Thank you.
One other, and I appreciate you reopening. I was delighted. I actually ran into you on the street when you were opening. And so I wanted to find out more of, like, other than the time, what else has changed? It sounds like we still have the same management group. Do you have community support? Any other folks that might?
I mean, since we've reopened, we've had several community events. We had ones called, what's her, you know the name of her company. She just did a program. I forgot her name, but her name's like Kazemi program. She did a program that participated with the marketplace and came to us. It was for young investors group. We have another program that's for the special needs because there's nowhere for them to go. So we're trying to host events for them so that they can come and do like a meet and greet. Special needs for one of our managers is he has a business where he takes care of special needs and stuff like that. We're trying to do things like that. Everybody we've spoken to in the community has not had a problem with us. Even the people, our neighbors next to us, we went and talked to them, and they said they don't have any problem with us opening up as a restaurant selling alcohol. It's not a problem. They just were worried about us being a nightclub again without operating first until, you know, they see like, we can do so, in which we try to tell everybody that it wasn't the way we were operating that made things happen this way. It was just a decision of someone who took it upon himself to do something that no one expected. We reacted the way we reacted, kept all our patrons safe with inside the venue, but outside the venue, police were already out on site, and he still did what he did. So that's out of our control, and that's what we kept trying to say. But I guess because anything that starts inside of a venue is your fault. So that's why we're holding ourselves accountable for whatever happened.
Kim, just to answer your question, I should have said this before. We got an email of no opposition from the Downtown Norfolk Civic League, but we did get a letter of email of opposition this morning from DNC.
Any other questions for the
applicant? Am I allowed to ask what that was? Because we keep finding out things in here. Like, I didn't even know about all these things. You said you had
We just got it this morning. I can forward it to you.
Okay.
Question of staff.
Okay. Ask Susan.
Yeah. So, again, I just want to make sure I fully understand. My first question is there any timeline on when this project goes from beta to an actual project as far as the Safe Nights? Is there any?
So I was in the program for the last 3 days. Mm-hmm. There is not established. They're trying to get, DNC indicates they're trying to get something in place by the summer. My opinion is they probably need a little more time.
And so that is DNC dependent, working with their consultant, correct?
Correct. It would be a DNC program. The city would participate, but it would be a DNC provided and funded program certification. It's an accreditation program is what it is.
And I asked a version of this question downstairs, but I just want to make sure, because having been on this commission for a while, there have been times when someone would apply, and if they were denied, they couldn't apply again immediately. Explain, is that the case here, or is that not what we're talking about today?
No, correct. There is nothing. There's no prior conditional use permit. There's no restaurant zoning certificate that has been revoked or anything that would prohibit them from applying and any amount of time.
If this, though, was approved and then got approved by council, I see there is a timeline in here, correct, about right. reapplying for a nightclub or something else. If this gets approved, there's a certain period of time before there could be any application, another application come forward.
So there are conditions. So again, with what we do with all applications, if you do decide to approve it, we have conditions in the staff report. Those conditions are slightly different than some of the conditions we would normally have in a restaurant with alcohol.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure that we were all aware of that, because we see these every month, and this is a little bit different. So.
I would like to say something again, though. with the Safe Night program, even being a part of the Safe Night program, until you actually activate it and doing stuff inside the program, even while it's in the beta phase so they can make corrections on the things that you're doing, you still can't take notes or make corrections on anything unless you're in it. So waiting for the program to drop and then trying to participate in something that's only voluntarily, which a lot of people don't think they need to do, is kind of like it's backwards, because how can we actually show that we're working and that it works for some, it's going to work for another business when they join if someone isn't participating in the beta phase? So that's kind of contradictory to what's trying to get done. And that's why I'm saying, like, us participating now is showing that we're trying to do everything in the measures so that when we do later on down the road want to involve ourselves in entertainment, we've already led we're the first on the list. We've already led, you know, the path for everyone else. Everyone else can come to us. They come ask us. I literally sat in that meeting at the Main for an hour and a half just listening to what's going on. And a lot of the stuff they're implementing is focused on nightclubs, because that's when a lot of the stuff happened. They said between the times of 10 and 3 p.m., you know, is when other businesses or people around them have to have more protections and security and stuff like that. They recommended that restaurants, they made a statement saying that restaurants don't utilize security because they don't think they need to, but nightclubs do. And if we have a better relationship with the police force and stuff like that, that'll help, you know, the relationship between, I guess, businesses and the city. But in my mind, it's not just having relations with the personnel that owns the business, because we still don't, it's about the businesses having relationships with the city, with the customers that's coming in. That's what I've been establishing. I literally, if you come to my business, everyone meets me, you have to meet me. I mean, that's a fact. So you know that you might second guess anything you might want to do outside of the normal that you would typically do. You come talk to me. And that's my de-escalation format now, approaching everyone and handling everything like I should. And I've taught all my managers that as well. So I'm a manager and owner. He's a manager and owner. And my other two, we're all childhood friends. We all grew up 24 years. We served our country, retired, and came here. And this is all we wanted to do after we retired was open a business and give back to our people. That's it. And other than that, something went left because someone made a bad decision, and we're affected by that wholeheartedly, and now we're trying to rebuild. And the only way to rebuild is by joining all the programs, going through all the new stipulations, all the new cup rules, all the new things that's implemented that hasn't even been enforced yet, because we're the first to actually come back after being taken away. And that's how I feel. So I'm with whatever you guys want to decide today. I'm just letting you know that in order for us to actually have effectiveness inside the Safe Night program, we have to be in the beta part. So.
Well, we appreciate you both coming downtown. Sure. Any other questions for the applicant, or okay, y'all can take a seat and
appreciate y'all.
Comments, commissioners.
Susan, so they're as a restaurant serving alcohol, they're not required to have a security plan.
Correct.
Is there a security plan? I guess maybe I should ask them.
My understanding is he's not proposing to have a security.
Okay. And I hope that's a vote of confidence that you don't see the business continuing to operate the same way as a nightclub, that it actually operating like a restaurant.
All right, those are the only people who signed up to speak. No opposition here. Any other comments before we call the vote? Susan, please call the vote.
Okay. The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit, subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. And just to let you know, the conditions that are a little bit different is we do talk about a 10:30 closing. We do tie them to managers. Generally, if there's no entertainment, we don't, but in this case, we would. We would require security, and then the condition that he was referencing, we do have it expire in 12 months. And then we also say the applicant shall not apply for any conditional use permits sooner than 8 months prior to such time that this permit has expired. So, subject
clarification, staff is not making a recommendation.
Our recommendation was to not support the request. We always read it in the positive, though. Ms. Austin.
Yeah, I'm going to follow the staff recommendation, and no.
Ms. Shelton.
No.
Mr. Bateman.
I believe that this is an opportunity to give these guys a second chance. And I think, you know, obviously you recognize you're the first to come back after having your license revoked. So I vote yes in hopes that we'll see good outcomes. And I'm going to come try the food. So,
Mr. McGee?
No.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Mr. Sutter?
I really wanted to say aye, but I also want to see a little more time pass to see how we perform as a restaurant. I don't put a time limit on it. I just want to see a little more time between reopening and establishing yourself back in the restaurant. So I'm going to vote no.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote no. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you very much for coming down today. That appears to be the end of our agenda. Commissioners, any comments, questions? Jeremy, do you have anything else to add today? Mr. Melita?
No, sir.
Thank you. This meeting's adjourned.